When I became a Christian many years ago, I came into a church, and what I saw around me, I thought this is the only normal thing. Because you adapt to your surroundings. So I saw, whoa, this is church, this is what it's all about. And I wanted, like everybody else, to serve God. Anybody want to serve God? Yeah, we want to bear fruit, we want to serve God. So I was thinking, how can I serve God? And in the church, what I saw around me, I could be a worship leader, there was worship, there was speaking, and there was practical things. And I'm not a singer, I have no tone in my life, I cannot sing. So worship was not me, okay. Then I could preach, but no, I was not preaching because there were other people who was already taking that seat. One day, then I could help with the practical things and be a usher, and I think it was good, so I helped in the church with practical things. But I felt like inside of me, I felt like that's small. I want to serve God, I want to do more. But my head was still so limited to the pulpit. I did not understand that I could already serve. I don't need an invitation. I don't need a pulpit. I don't need a mic in my hand. I could already do it out by there. But because my head was limited, I thought it's all about the pulpit, all about the mic. So I said to my friend, youth leader at the time, when is my turn to preach? I wasn't one to preach. He said, Tom, it's not a problem. You just help in the summer school. And after a few years, you can be a summer school leader. Then after a few years, you can be a youth leader. And after a few years as a youth leader, you are going to preach one Sunday in a year. And he said that to me. So I was standing, looking at my hand, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years. If I do anything I should do in this city, it would take me 5 years to preach one Sunday. And it was just like an eye-opening for me, because I turned around and what did I see? I saw a lot of lovely people who really loved God, but was sorry doing absolutely nothing. They were stuck there. They have a lot of knowledge. They have been Christian many years, but they were still sitting there Sunday after Sunday and nothing was happening. And it started frustrating me, and it started a journey me, because I thought I need to leave this place. Because if I continue here, I will also be stuck like everybody else. So we fled that church, came to another city where they're doing a church plant. And it was funny because now we have a church plant, it was a small city, so after 2 weeks it was my turn to preach. And I still remember I was sitting there on the beach and I was going to preach something. What am I going to preach about? I heard somebody preach about this. No, it was not a good sermon. Yeah, I'm going to take this one. And I stood up and I preached and it was really not good. But I got started. And I learned that it's all about getting started. And after a year there, we were young, we had no experience, so we moved to another city to start a new church plant again. And I had been Christian 6 years at that time, and in many eyes, I was a radical guy who was out and working in church plant and telling about Jesus, but if I look at my life, I was frustrated. There was no fruit. I really never led anybody to Christ. I never healed a sick, I never cast out a demon. There was no fruit. So in frustration one day I said, God, I give you one more year. If I do not bear fruit next year, cut me off. And I decided to fast 40 days. And God just did something in me. And 1 year later, everything was changed. I've seen people saved. I've seen people healed. Not like today, because it continued growing. But the frustration was still there in many ways, because how do we give this to other people? Because now I was leader in a church. And I saw some fruits in my life, but the people who was in our church did not grow. And I became frustrated again, and very often I felt, what is wrong with me? Why do I not fit in this church thing? What is wrong with me? I just want to serve God. And it was so hard again because I was like hit into a wall. And there God, he started journeying us. And he took us through a long journey. I would say it took about 7 years. Ten, maybe more tomorrow, but my wife got sick, I got fired, yay, I lost my house, yay. I did not say yay when that happened. I say yay today, because it was good. But I got fired, I lost my house, we went through this, and my wife was sick, laying in bed, and I wanted to die. To do a little short. But out there, when you lose anything, out there, away from everything, it was like God took me away, and I was seeing everything from outside. And I'm like, why do we do that? Why have I been doing that? Because this is not what I read there. And I stood there with the Bible in one hand and everything I've been believing and doing in another hand and saw something do not fit. And God then continued to start my journey. And it was so interesting because before, and in that journey, when God revealed things to us, we had moved to a new city one more time. We love moving. Our son is 17 years old. He had lived 13 places. But in all of that, then one day, God started to reveal a lot of things to me. I started to see how the Holy Spirit led me more and more and more. And God, amazing testimony. It's like how the Holy Spirit is leading me. One amazing testimony I shared in Pioneer School, it was one day I was out praying and seeing God, and then I felt the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, pray for open door to TV so you can go against evolution and Darwin. Okay. God, I thank you for open door to TV, God. Okay. Pray that evolution Darwin was fallen, and I prayed for that open door to TV. When I was out praying there, suddenly I saw a famous stand-up comedian in Denmark. Simon Juhl is his name. And I saw him and I was like, this is Simon Juhl! This is Simon Juhl! So my heart started to beat and I became nervous and we know what that means. I need to go to him. So I think, well, I need to go to him. So I went to him. But just before I came to him, he turned his face, and I saw his face from the front. Hi, Star Simon Juhl! It was just one who looked like that stand-up comedian, Simon Juhl. And then I felt God spoke to me again. Pray for Simon Juhl. And I was like, huh? Pray for Simon Juhl. The one who looked like, or the real one? The real one. Okay. And it was not like a big voice. I don't hear voices. It was a thought. So I was like, crazy thought. Okay. So I was like, God, I pray for open doors to TV so I can go against evolution, and I pray for Simon Yu. And it's strange to pray for somebody you don't know like that. Do something, send somebody to him, save him, God, do something. And I prayed like that. But when I came home that day, just when I entered home, okay, the telephone called and I took it. Yeah, Tom, shut up. Hello. This is from Danish TV. We are making a program about evolution and Darwin. And we want to hear if you want to be a part of it. The one who's interviewing you is the stand-up comedian Simon Juhl. And I was like, what? And I said, I'm ready. So God put in my heart, pray for open doors to TV, so I go against evolution and Darwin, pray for Simon Juhl. 2 weeks later, I was sitting in Copenhagen beside Simon Juhl. Not the one who looked like the real one. And we were sitting on a coffee shop and eating, and I said, Simon, I'm here because of you. I prayed for you that day. God spoke to me that I should pray for you that day. Your secretary called me, and now I'm here. God wants you to repent. And suddenly I was the only one eating, the older looked at me like, who's that guy? But we went to the street of Copenhagen, and they were filming us, and we stopped people and talked about God and evolution. And there came a young guy with cross, I just knew this God, I prayed for him, God healing, he walked without crosses, and I stood with both crosses here over my shoulder, and Simon just looked at me and said like, what is this? And he started so tall, I stood like this, what do you mean? This! What is this? And I stood with the crosses. not read the Bible, this is for reading Bible. Afterward, we went to Zoologisk Museum in Copenhagen, where I got put on a chair with two spotlights. I was sitting in a chair, Simon was sitting in front of me, sorry, you must see it all, and there was two spotlights on me. And it was really weird. I was sitting like here, Simon was sitting there, two spotlights me, and behind me we have one missing link that is still missing. And I was sitting there, and in 1.5 hours he was asking questions about God and evolution and DNA. Do you really believe in Noah's Ark? Do you really believe God created heaven and earth 6 days, 24 hours? What about fossils? What about DNA? What if God say you're going to kill your wife, are you going to do it? What about that? In 1.5 hours, he just sat and asked me question after question after question. And to describe it the best way, it was like being in heaven. Because in 1.5 hours, I knew everything. I was just sitting there, and exactly like the Bible says, don't be afraid what you are going to say, because in saying only the Holy Spirit is going to give you what to say. And 1.5 hours I just came and came, and after 1.5 hours I'll pop up. More, come on, hit more. And he was like, he took me beside and he looked at me and said, who are you? What are you? And I got the chance to share the gospel to him. He did not get saved yet. And people asked me afterwards, Tom, why do you go to a program like that where they normally make fun with people? Stand-up comedian, you know? And I would say to them, I did not go there because he mad at me. I went there because God sent me. And then I don't need to know anything, everything. Because when God sent, he's in control. And they were into it, because when I then saw a lady on TV, they forgot one thing in the program. I don't know what happened, but Darwin got lost. Because suddenly it was just my testimony of how this guy got healed, and it came out to me 100,000 in Denmark, and people came to faith because of it. And I got one experience like this, another experience, a further experience, and I saw more and more how the Holy Spirit was leading. And in that desert period, my experience was one day God spoke to me and said that we were going to go to a desert, but our pain was over. And God was going to take a famous businessman in our country, and he was going to support us. But we did not see anything of that in the beginning. Because in the desert, we lost more and lost more and lost everything. And in that desert period, one day, I think God said, what we need in pioneers, start a pioneer school. And I was thinking, what is pioneer? So I started in my, we had a basement there. I set up a camera and I was standing in front of my camera and there was nothing in the room, me and the camera and a man behind me. We had moved to that city, I did not know anybody in that city. We had lost all our friends at that time, we had lost all our money and we did not have any network. So when I went out, I wanted to visit people, there was nobody to visit. So I started with that camera and just sharing some of the teaching I saw and what God had revealed to me. And it was interesting because people asked me before, Tom, how many do you hope will see the pioneer school? I thought, I don't know, it'd be nice if there are 300 who want to see it. Now the first lesson there is 120,000. Something like that. So it's more than 300. And what was interesting, I just did the teaching. Because now I have lost anything, and because you have lost anything, you have nothing more to lose. So I thought, okay, nobody can fire me, nobody can throw me off, nobody can stop inviting me because nobody will invite me. So I just say what I saw and what I longed for, and what I was surprised of, to be honest. I was so surprised that it was not only something that happened in me. It happened in many people, no? Because many people, when they saw the Bible school, they came and said, Tom, and when they read my book, Tom, you just put words on what we already believed in. Anybody recognize that? There was just a confirmation for some of the things the Holy Spirit had already started to do in other people. So I just suddenly become a part of what the Holy Spirit was already doing. After being there in our city, did not know anything, one day God said, as soon as I entered the pile in school, God said, now you can move to another city. God said, move to that city. And I looked at that city and looked at a house we rent, but come on, we did not have money. We lost everything, come on. And a house there would cost like almost like $18,000 in euro to take over the house, and yeah, 15,000 euro to take over the house and so on and rent that. And we had never had 15,000 euro in our bank account. But I knew it was God, so I went to bed and slept. And I woke up every hour that night, I'm moving to that city. I'm moving to that city. And I just bumping outside of me. When I woke up the next day, I checked my bank account and I was like, my eyes, what is happening? All of those numbers. And suddenly there was somebody who had put 15,000 euro on a bank account. And I was like, what? So we went to that city, rented a house. And then I met that guy who had put that money on a bank account. I did not know him, but I love him already. So I met him because he was living close to that house, and I said, hi, thank you for the money, who are you? And then it seems it was a famous football player who had been playing us in the National League many years before. With the big guys, Brian Laudrup and Mike Laudrup and Jürgen Odos. And he was playing with them, but he got problems in his hip because of it. But one day he saw a video on the internet, put their hands on their hip and got them. And then he gave his life to God and got baptized. And God has said that he should support us. And that guy has now bought four houses and a hotel that we are using. So now we don't live in a basement anymore with 65 square meters. Now we have in the old houses we have 100 beds and a lot of people. It's not mine, I don't own anything, it's him, but he just helped us. And I just saw that God, since that the last, and it's only 2 years actually since this ended, and the last 2 years they have just been crazy. And can we get the website up? Because the last 2 years, things have forced and all over the world exploded. And what is due that we see that for us to dare to step up just encourage other people to say, hey, if Tom he can do it, we can do it. We don't have to be afraid. God is enough. And I say, when you hear all of that, well, 4 years ago, 3 years ago, I was alone in a city. I did not have any friends. And then now, look at the network right now. Just go, this is the man. And they have just exploded the last years. Who is on the map here? Look at all of those people. And many people here have got baptized, have led other people to Christ, and people are now connecting all over. And we really see it as a movement. Just try to go out so we can see America and everyone. Can you zoom out? It's all over the world. There is, And one situation, a few days ago, somebody sent me a video, and I have to remember, but I forgot. It was a video from Philippines. The last Reformation in Philippines, how we baptize people in a Bilibin and how people get set free from demons. And I'm like, oh, it's also in Philippines. And like, people just take it by itself, translate it, give it out, and life is getting changed. And we hear it's like 10,000 of testimonies. And the whole kickstart is just transforming the whole world. If I said Sweden alone, Peter in our last Reformation movie, he came to Denmark around 4 years ago. Still when we were around the desert period, but I kickstarted him out on the street. Peter, he went home to Denmark to Sweden to kickstart order, train order, to kickstart order, to train order, to kickstart order, to kickstart and train order. When I was in Sweden 1.5 years later, in Sweden we were a group out on the street, and there was a person who was out on the street and training another person to heal the sick. And I asked, amazing, you did it. Who trained you? That person. I don't know you. Who trained you? That person. I don't know you. Who trained you? That person. I don't know. Who trained you? That person. I don't know you. So I saw in 1.5 years, these have already gone for 7 generations. Like one person had trained one, but trained one, but trained one, but trained one, but trained one. And two of those persons, just in that group, have seen more than 1,000 healing in 1 year. So if we talk about Sweden and low, if we talk about Sweden alone, there's, we talk about maybe 100,000 people getting healed the last few years. And not just healing, they're leading people to Christ. Peter here maybe baptized, I think it's around 30 or what it is, maybe more. He had led to Christ non-believers the last 3 years. So right now there is something new that has started and is spreading all over the world. And it's just a simple thing of going back to the truth, back to what the gospel really is, back to discipleship, and back to that everybody can serve. We are all priests. We are all called. We are all ordained. And we don't need to have a mic in our hand to bear fruit. We can do it where we are. If you have the Holy Spirit in you, you have a bathtub of home. If you have a coffee machine, and if you can bake cake, you have all you need. And it is spreading. And I'm saying this not to say it for what we are doing. I just want to say that what was hard for me in the beginning, when we a few years ago started to step out, was that we felt alone. It was really hard because you are taking some steps, but you feel alone. And there is another fear still, like, okay, am I allowed to do it? Can I actually do it? And it had been a long journey. But now you're not alone anymore. You don't have to be alone anymore. Now you can connect with other people. And then we have been given a lot of tools you can use. Invite people to your house. If you don't know how to share the gospel beginning, invite everyone to your house. Put the movie on. You take care of the coke and the popcorn. You see the movie and then you baptize them afterwards. Pioneer school. This is the first place to start. The Pioneer School. If you have not seen it, please go home and see those training lessons, because it's so much more than what we have been teaching here. This is only the beginning. There is more.